this panel about Midwestern history. We are going to follow the order in the program as it's set forth, which has Ray Boomhower going first, Ray of the Indiana Historical Society Press. Ray is currently the director of the press, and he's also the editor of the Indiana Historical Society's popular history magazine, which I know many of you have seen, called Traces of Indiana and Midwestern History. Before joining the society in 1987, Ray worked as a reporter for two Indiana daily newspapers. Along with a long list of articles for Traces and the Indiana Magazine of History, Ray is the author of numerous books on Indiana history. One of the most recent ones I'm sure many of you have seen is the biography of Ernie Pyle. He's also written biographies of Lew Wallace. You may remember was the Indiana man who wrote Ben-Hur back in the 19th century. He's also written books about Robert Kennedy in the famous 1968 Indiana primary, where Kennedy was in Indianapolis the night Martin Luther King was shot. But his newest book, Ray's newest book, is entitled John Barlow Martin, A Voice for the Underdog, which was published by Indiana University Press, and it recently won the biography honor, which is given out every year by the Society for Midland Authors over in Chicago. So please welcome Ray.
Thank you, John. It's an honor to be with you today. I must admit that I approached the subject of my talk with some trepidation. John Barton would, I believe, have no problem being associated with a competence on Midwestern history, but you might well scoff at being labeled an intellectual, even a public intellectual. If you look at the picture of Martin on the cover of my biography of him, in his heyday at his home in Highland Park, Illinois in the 1950s, he certainly displays all the hallmarks of a stereotypical intellectual, or egghead in the parlance of his time. He sports a pair of formerly glasses and wears a bow tie, not unlike the ones favored by his friend and fellow Democratic political insider Arthur Schlesinger Jr., who would have no problem in being labeled a public intellectual, I'm sure. Martin, who viewed writing more as carpentry than art, had no pretensions about his place in American society. "Hell, I'm just a reporter," he once told the interviewer. Early in his career as a journalist, Martin honed his keen observational skills as a police, City Hall, and rewrite reporter for the Indianapolis Times. And he possessed the essential qualities required by any good journalist: talent, guts, idealism mixed with realism, durability, independence, accuracy, and effectiveness. In the 1940s and 1950s, he regularly contributed to the prestigious Harper's Magazine, saw his work appear in the Big Slicks, the mass circulation magazines that dominated popular culture before television took over, especially that mainstay of the middle class audience, the Saturday Evening Post. His idea of heaven, said his son Fred, was reaching a mass audience with a serious piece of writing or rhetoric. His idea of hell was academic life. Martin became, as the Post called him on the covers of his issue that featured his stories, America's number one prize women reporter and one of America's great reporters. For nearly 50 years as a freelance writer, he began his day by getting to his desk at 9 o'clock in the morning, taking a half hour for lunch and taking the weekend off. Just like any other office worker or tradesman making his living, Fred noted, only his father made stories. Martin also found time to produce two classic books for the Knopf Publishing House, exploring specific regions in the Midwest, call it North Country, the story of Upper Michigan, detailing the lives of miners, hunters, trappers, and lumberjacks who first populated the hardy land of the Upper Peninsula. And one of my favorite books, Indiana, An Interpretation, which is still considered one of the best books about Indiana and its people. And it's being republished by Indiana University Press this July, and a special edition for our state bicentennial. East Coast editors relied on Martin to help explain to them and to their readers what people in the Midwest were thinking. New York Magazine editors, said Martin, at least the good ones, felt cooped up in New York, isolated from the rest of the country. Time and time again, they asked him, what's the mood of the Midwest these days? What's going on out there? As Martin noted, just as farm boys yearn to go to New York, so do New York editors yearn to know what's on the farm boys' minds. Sometimes they sounded almost anxious about this. Occasionally, what Martin discovered on these assignments overwhelmed his intended audience. In 1946, after he returned from stateside service in World War II, he took on an assignment for Life magazine to do an article on the post-war mood in the Midwest. He spent 6 weeks traveling between Columbus, Ohio and Smith Center, Kansas, and between Louisville, Kentucky and Bismarck, North Dakota, collecting hundreds of pages of notes on issues such as race relations in Louisville and Indianapolis, farmers' cooperatives in Minnesota, life on an assembly line in Kansas City, conversion from tank manufacturing to building automobiles for the civilian market in Michigan, and labor strikes in Ohio and Indiana. Everywhere I asked, what are people talking about, and who runs this town, and how did it change during the war, and will it go back to the way it was? He sent 500 pages of notes to Life and asked its editors what kind of article they wanted him to carve out of it. Eventually, the magazine's editors didn't know what to do with all this material and decided to instead pay Martin for his time but never published his article. He did not consider the work wasted as he learned a lot about the Midwest and used what he had learned in his later career as a political speechwriter. A friend of Martin who also worked for Time Life Incorporated said that both of the magazines, Time and Life, continued to use those hundreds of pages of notes that Martin produced on the Midwest in the years to come when they thought about and wrote about the Midwest. Martin explored the Midwestern mood throughout his career. In 1958, he wrote a four-part series about the changing Midwest for the Saturday Evening Post that saw him visit a farm town, Rushville, Indiana, a factory town, Flint, Michigan, as well as Indianapolis, Chicago, Madison, and Abilene, Kansas. He asked the questions, what is going on in the Midwest? What are people there thinking and talking about? Can any changes be detected in this once bucolic, complacent, comfortable, isolated inland heart of America? He asked these kinds of questions because he believed that by exploring the Midwest, he and his readers could learn something about America at large. Americans were on the move as never before. Martin found the Midwest filling up, open land disappearing. Cornfields were becoming school playgrounds. The cities were swallowing rural villages. A wild helter-skelter growth was consuming the earth of the old Northwest. The people were, on the whole, prosperous, but it was a prosperity tinged with apprehension. They worried about another depression cropping up. There also existed a desire in people's parts not to be bothered, and an overall indifference to public affairs, with government becoming so big and remote, there was nothing that they could do about it. After 20 years of depression and war, Martin said, being constantly summoned to great deeds, the people were weary and wanted just to be left alone. The only issue that might kind of serve to arouse them was the Soviet Union's recent success in space with Sputnik. That series for the Post, which marked Martin's 52nd article for the magazine, showcased, I think, his dedication to his craft. While he was touring a Buick factory in Flint, which he described as a noisy, hot, somewhat frightening place where the air was filled with ladles of molten metal flying around, he started to smell smoke. But because the entire factory was smoky, he thought nothing of it and continued to take notes until a companion noticed that started yelling, "You're on fire." "I was too," reflected Martin, who included that cost of his ruined suit in his expense account, minus depreciation that he gave to the Post. Martin was a perfect choice for these mood of the Midwest articles that these magazines seemed to love running, as he possessed a strong sense of place, a sense that he belonged here in the Midwest, and he'd always done a lot of place writing, descriptions of places, setting the scenes, using place as a character in his stories. He began to see that living in the Midwest was, for him, as a freelance writer, a tremendous advantage. After all, the Midwest, as he said, is where things happened. It was almost the locomotive of America. And I, as a writer, almost had it all to myself, while in New York, little happened, and writers were scrambling all over each other to write about it. In his long career, he took his readers into the worlds of such forgotten people of the Midwest as victims of a gruesome highway crash in Michigan, the mother of a teenage boy who wondered why her son and two others killed a nurse for no apparent reason in Ann Arbor, a convict from Jackson Prison talking about the hell of life behind bars, and coal miners in Centralia, Illinois, doomed to die because their pleas for help were ignored by union and government officials. He dealt with sensational material, so that he said of his friend, in a way that was both intensely serious and intensely readable. Journalist Herman Kogan said that the range of the subjects that his friend Martin tackled during his writing career made the rest of us look like bums. Adding that when a reader finished one of Martin's pieces, he knew everything there was to know about that subject. He never bored you. Something else set Martin apart from his contemporaries, including such renowned journalists as Theodore White and Scotty Reston: a deep and abiding concern for the lot of individual beings in a society growing increasingly complex, dysfunctional, and unforgiving. Most journalists, he said, make a living by interviewing the great. I made mine by interviewing the humble, or what the Spaniards, please excuse my Spanish, call los de abajo, those from below. Martin made a distinction between a story and an article. I write stories, he said. Stories have people in them, and they bleed. Martin became entranced by the condition of the underdog in American society because of his early life, I think. He was born in Hamilton, Ohio on August 4th, 1915, the eldest son of J.W. and Lord Barlow Martin. And when Martin was young, his father, who was a carpenter and later a contractor, moved the family to Indianapolis. Since he was a contractor and did public work there, there was always a lot of talks about politics and deals, said Martin. A lifelong Democrat, the senior Martin refused to join the Ku Klux Klan, which was, as you all know, a significant force in the Boomhower state in the 1920s. One of the young Martin's earliest memories involved watching a seemingly endless parade of robed and hooded Klansmen marching around a monument circle in dead silence. He was a scholarly child. His father rightly called him the bookworm, and his Hoosier life was filled with dismal memories. His father suffered severe financial setbacks during the Great Depression, and his business failed. Two of Martin's younger brothers died in early childhood. And these tragedies helped tear apart his parents' marriage. When he was writing his memoirs, he said, most people who write these kinds of books seem to have had happy childhoods. I hated mine. Martin may have endured many hardships growing up, but he had no difficulty in deciding upon a writing career. Throughout high school and even in grade school, he wanted to become a writer. His teachers at his high school encouraged him to read such noted authors of the day as John Dos Passos, Sinclair Lewis, Sherwood Anderson, Theodore Dreiser, Thomas Wolfe, and above all, Ernest Hemingway. He read them all, some several times, including Dos Passos' 42nd Parallel and Wolfe's Look Homeward, Angel, for in the first he found a world he aspired to know, and in the second he thought he could see himself. With financial support from his grandmother, he attended DePauw University in Greencastle. By his own admission, he behaved like a fool during his freshman year of college, spending more time drinking and playing cards in his fraternity house than in studying, and he was expelled eventually because of a drunken incident. He joined his father in walking the streets looking for work. This is during the height of the Great Depression in the 1930s. His father finally found employment as a foreman with the New Deal's Works Progress Administration, and the Martin family had his home saved thanks to the Homeowners Loan Corporation. Roosevelt saved us all, said Martin. The New Deal touched our lives directly. It gave us many things. What it gave us above all else was hope. Martin kept his dreams of being a writer alive by finding work with the Indianapolis office of the Associated Press, getting the princely sum of $9 a week. I received a promotion tonight, copy boy, and began to learn about the reporter's trade. He wanted to continue with the AP, but the chief of the bureau said, no, you need to go back to DePauw and get your degree, and Martin did so. He was readmitted to the university in early 1935 and honed his writing skills by working as an editor on the daily newspaper at the university and also as a stringer for the Indianapolis Times. While he was still in school, he was offered a full-time job by the Times and left, got his degree in absentia. The Times, whose sympathies lay primarily with the Democratic Party, hired you young, paid you little, and promoted you fast, according to Martin. His work impressed Norman Isaacs, who was a newspaper's managing editor, and told him instead of working for a newspaper, he should be writing stories for magazines. At the age of 23, Martin left Indiana and moved to Evanston, Illinois with his wife, Barbara, and moved in with her father, who was a rich businessman. After the move, his wife informed him that she wanted a divorce, left him, and so Martin was on his own, deciding to try his hand at full-time freelance writing, and had a home base at the Hotel Miller in Chicago, where he had just one suitcase and his portable typewriter. Chicago had always been a beacon of hope for Martin as a possible means of escape from the dark memories of his Indianapolis neighborhood. He said that he lived on Brookside Avenue, which he called a mean street in a mean city. The horizons in Indiana seemed suffocatingly close. The ceiling in Chicago, on the other hand, unlimited. And as fast as I could, I went. Chicago to Martin was a hub of the prairies, the magnet that draws the young with bright lights and excitement and boundless opportunity. And in those early years in Chicago, he earned his livelihood mainly writing articles for the fact detective magazines of the day, official detective stories and actual detective stories of women and crime. He worked as hard at this writing as at any he ever did, and given the constrictions of the genre, made it as good as he could. Thus, he learned the uses of description, dialogue, characterization, and perhaps above all, narrative pull, that mysterious invisible force that pulls the reader onward. Martin was almost obsessively concerned with the precarious existence of being a freelance writer. He once described his profession as champagne today, crackers and milk tomorrow. Careerism prevented him from becoming seriously interested in politics until he was 37 years old. And even in college in the 1930s, a time of some serious ferment, he'd been too preoccupied with getting a diploma and a job take part in any of the peace marches and other campus protests at the time. World War II largely passed him by. I was aware that I was living through great events, but even though I was in the Army, I was not really engaged in those great events. I was intent on getting out of the Army and getting on with my writing and my private life. After the war, when he wrote for serious magazines about public events and public officials, did not engage him in politics. Instead, they were stories to be written, not events to be myself involved with. That all changed in the 1950s when he was asked by a friend to edit a book of speeches by Illinois Governor Adlai Stevenson. And when Stevenson went on to win the 1952 Democratic nomination, Martin went to work for the governor, becoming a member of a group of speechwriters dubbed the Elks Club. Because they called that because they had their headquarters in the Elks Club in Springfield, Illinois, where Stevenson had his campaign headquarters. He soon developed a harmonious working relationship with Schlesinger on rough drafts of speeches. Schlesinger would write the substantive center of the speech, while Martin wrote the pleasantries and set up at the beginning and the rising rhetoric at the end. The following years after Stevenson's loss were busy ones for Martin, also tragic ones. He went to work for John Kennedy's administration as ambassador to the Dominican Republic, worked hard to help support the first democratically elected government there, but returned to the United States when that government fell in a military coup, and returned to Washington in time to learn about John Kennedy's assassination. Still, Martin believed that his political experience contributed in the long run to him being a better reporter. He worked for every Democratic presidential candidate from Stevenson in 52 all the way to George McGovern's campaign in 1972. Working for politicians gained a new appreciation on the difficulties involved in conducting public affairs. He became less zealous about attacking the failings of our public officials and arrogating all virtues to the vigilant press. I found out just how hard governing really is. And whatever disappointments and tragedies that came in his life, he coped by retreating to the solitude of Michigan's Upper Peninsula, where he had a cabin. And over the years, that remote, wild region became for him the most healing place on earth. He loved going up there for the summer months and relaxing, trying his hand at carpentry, writing, and also, relaxing in a sauna that I visited when I was doing my book on Martin. And one of the features of the sauna was the front page of the New York Times announcing the resignation of Richard Nixon, who was always a foil, a longtime foil for Martin. Martin died on January 3rd, 1987, at the age of 71 from throat cancer. Just a few weeks before his death, he had a visitor, his old friend, Arthur Schlesinger Jr. The two men shared stories about their times together in politics with the likes of Stevenson's and the Kennedy brothers. Before he departed, Schlesinger got a note from Martin that he scribbled on a pad because he could no longer speak. He said, "We had the best of it." Thank you.
Thank you, Ray. Our next speaker is Sara Kosiba, who is an associate professor of English at Troy University. Her research focuses primarily on Midwestern writers from the 1920s and 30s, and one of her recent projects was the republication of Michigan writer John Herman's first novel, which was entitled What Happens? And it was recently acknowledged with a 2016 Michigan Notable Book Award. She is the past president of the Society for the Study of Midwestern Literature, and she currently serves as the Midwestern History Association's liaison to the Society for the Study of Midwestern Literature. Please take it away, Sara.
I'll add to that last bit so that we've had some history cred here. At least I'm a liaison. A couple of really quick things. One, I'm running a conference next year on regionalism and place in American literature in New Orleans for anybody who wants to come. I'm kind of hoping for it to be a sort of interdisciplinary regional summit of sorts that focuses on American lit. So I'm going to find wherever I can put these afterward, but also if you want to find if you'd like a copy of the CFP, please let me know. I also was in Detroit yesterday and stopped by John King Books because I had never been there, the infamous like four-story used bookstore that is like heaven to anybody who likes to read. And I was amused because I almost brought it as a prop. In the Midwest History and Culture section, there was a book titled The Last of the Middle West, and it was published in the middle of the 20th century, so apparently we're all way behind the curve. I found my way into this program rather late. I was stirring off Evergreen or conference papers at the moment, and then John sent me an email and said, "Hey, we've got this spot on a paper on Midwestern intellectual history, a panel on Midwestern intellectual history." And I said, "Sounds like fun." So apparently, I need to work on my self-discipline. The title, though, of my paper is the reason for some of that background, because it's based on a placeholder title. I did a chapter for a Salem Press book on Midwestern literature about a year ago. With that title, What is Middlewestishness, the Evolution of Midwestern Literary Studies. Anyone wondering where that quote, Middlewestishness, comes from, it's a Ford Maddox Ford comment that I find continually sort of fascinating. But if I was to revise my comments for today, my title would more accurately be Kids These Days, This is Still Your Great-Grandfather's and Grandfather's Literary Midwest. So I apologize a bit for my screen here. As part of a panel on Midwestern intellectualism, I want to use my time to reflect on much of the contemporary short-sightedness for a more extensive sense of Midwestern intellectual history. Particularly in a literary sense, as that's my area of expertise. While I applaud the resuscitation of interest in Midwestern history and Midwestern studies in recent years, particularly as I've witnessed what I hope are the last years because of this resurgence of the Midwest's role as the, quote, bastard stepchild, as I like to call it, of American regions, I also find myself continually lamenting among this resurgence a tendency at times within articles and discussions to act as if the authors are the first to raise their voices or notice the region and its significance. This tends to appear more in the pop culture venues and online discussions more than scholarly circles. But in our media frenzied world, those articles and perceptions often gain a lot of visibility and credence. So permit me to invoke a certain element of curmudgeonliness that is not perhaps yet entirely earned at this stage of my career, but one that I tend toward nonetheless. This is, in a way, I suppose, my lament, or what I'd imagine maybe those earlier literary critics or scholars might say in light of recent discussions, toward a kids these days sort of discussion. And granted, using the term kids rather loosely, because many of these are grown adults. I was born in the Midwest, in Wisconsin, and came to Midwestern Studies, as many of us do, out of a sense of outrage at the lack of presence of a regional history or literature within my education and general worldview. I didn't really experience a Wisconsin writer, especially in a sense that there was any Wisconsin literary history, until I was an undergraduate in college. And then I famously like to say it was one reference in a class on vampires in literature, August Sterling. That's where I learned my Midwestern writers. As I worked to fill the gaps in my knowledge in graduate school, I realized that the primary reason I was so underinformed was that society as a whole, even in the Midwest, and even in locations where these writers were often living and working, was also often underinformed about these writers and texts. Other than the big Midwestern writers, Sinclair Lewis, Ernest Hemingway, F. Scott Fitzgerald, Willa Cather, almost all the other names, even bestsellers of their time, had been marginalized or forgotten. We need to be careful in how we frame our discussions of this literary history today, however, as we are not necessarily finding these writers for the first time, these supposedly lost writers. We are refinding what scholars and critics of the past were often well aware of. To be lost, to borrow the regional premise from the title of this conference and Jon Lauck's fantastic book on Midwestern history, he didn't pay me to put that plug in, means that at one time it was known. To know we have lost something is to know that we once had something to lose in the first place. In addition to refinding these texts, then, we need to recapture that intellectual history in context as well. As I worked on my dissertation on Midwestern writers, my advisor, who was rather clueless on Midwestern studies as a subject but willing to work with me, tasked me with theorizing the Midwest, and I think half of that task was partially so he even knew what he was dealing with. In order to write about the authors in my study, I didn't just learn about the authors themselves or their fictional works. I pulled everything I could find on Midwestern literary studies on Midwestern culture. What I found, and what is often underemphasized in popular contemporary discussions of Midwestern literature, is that while we can trace Midwestern writers back to the exploration and founding of areas that would eventually become the United States, and go all the way back to those exploration narratives, Midwestern literary theory also has a rather distinguished history, extending back at least to the early 20th century. Essentially paralleling the more significant discussions of American literature as its own area of emphasis. If we lose those voices by failing to acknowledge their presence, we lose the intellectual history that underpins our understanding of the Midwest and that can potentially help answer some of the questions we continue to struggle with regarding the Midwest. How do we define region? What characteristics make us Midwestern? To show that there's a need in popular and contemporary discussions of Midwestern literature for that longer intellectual view, I want to cite a few examples. My observations are not comprehensive, so please clearly counter my views after this talk with any examples to the contrary if you have them. This is based on things that I've caught in my reading. As I will acknowledge that I, as much as anyone, am potentially susceptible to confirmation bias. Maybe I'm only seeing the ones that take me on. I also want to note that I don't know the individuals I'm calling out in these examples, so their knowledge and opinions may be more nuanced, but I'm critiquing what has appeared in print, which is, I guess, my Midwestern nice disclaimer. I'm not trying to attack anybody here. I'm just saying this is what the word said. In September of 2014, the Chicago Tribune published the opinion of 9 publishing professionals, responding to the question of why hasn't Midwestern literature emerged as a cohesive literary tradition in the public imagination? Of the 9 responses, only writer Stuart Dybeck seemed to even challenge or ponder the question of whether the question was potentially valid. Quote, I don't know that Midwestern lit has not emerged as a cohesive tradition, but I suppose if we compare it to the most cohesive tradition in the U.S., the South, that it is true by comparison. Maybe even the same if we compare it to the East Coast and the West. And I think that is one way to answer your question. The geographical term Midwest doesn't double neatly as a cultural or literary term. Many of the responses in that piece in the Chicago Tribune argue for a universal or American quality that may defy a specific regional categorization. such as in the comments of Jeremiah Chamberlain, director of the English Writing Program at the University of Michigan. Quote, so perhaps the problem with Midwestern literature not emerging as a cohesive tradition has less to do with the fact that it is hard to define, and more that it represents American literature in general, again, hiding in plain sight. This moves us further from a sense of Midwestern distinctiveness and once again lumps us into an American universality, diluting what identity the Midwest might have. Elsewhere in the article, moving from the amorphous to the distinctively problematic, some comments implied that there was no groundwork established for a Midwestern literary tradition, such as the response of Jane Honer, who is now Jane Ferreira, director of Wayne State University Press, who applauded the diversity of Midwestern literature, but finished with the optimistic yet short-sighted comment, quote, the beauty of this is that there is nowhere to go but up for the myriad authentic Midwestern voices. A canon of Midwestern literature is bound to form. I would argue strongly that the long tradition of literary criticism focused on Midwestern literature has already formed a working canon, one unfortunately unknown by far too many. Not a single response within this piece, other than the general comment made by Dybeck, alluded to any work by previous critics on this very question, or even noted that there is in existence a long history of debating this very issue. I've been reading Mark Athatakis's promotion of recent Midwestern literature in Belt magazine with some similar concern. While Athatakis clearly embraces Midwestern literature and has a sense of the literature itself, his comments often seem more of a reader response reflection than those generated by someone acknowledging a larger theoretical or intellectual tradition. One small recent exception is in a piece published on April 7, 2016, titled Writing from the Borderlands, where he notes geographer James Shortridge's work in tracing the definition of the Midwest. But I would argue, why is Shortridge the only cited commentary on Midwestern characteristics? In that same piece, Athatakis also makes generalized statements that, in essence, negate decades of previous literary commentary. Athatakis begins Writing from the Borderlands by citing recent online polls that present individuals with an opportunity to define what they feel is the Midwest. He recognizes the clickbait attraction of providing folks with an opportunity to express their opinion, but as he transitions that commentary into a discussion of how those diverse definitions might fit the classification of what is or isn't Midwestern literature in his upcoming book, The New Midwestern Canon, he states, quote, I can't write about everything, I know, but that's a cop-out. Long or short, the project requires me to make my own decision about what qualifies as the Midwest, and by extension, the literature that's part of it. He does have to make his own assessment, but why not rely on or consult a long tradition of literary commentary and theory that may have already made compelling cases for inclusion or exclusion? This may be what he ultimately ends up doing in the forthcoming The New Midwestern Canon, which is supposedly appearing in December 2016. But his article suggests a looser acknowledgement to any of that preceding intellectual tradition. For example, in the same article, while reflecting on whether a text like Toni Morrison's Beloved is a part of the Midwest, Athatakis states, quote, the Midwest of our collective imagination is an integrationist one, however unsuccessful that integration was. This comment is both insightful and yet problematic. By noting that our collective imagination, and I assume by our he's saying American society, believes in a utopian sense of racial integration in the Midwest. Athatakis is adding credibility to that misguided or underinformed view by point of view by stating it as a larger acknowledged fact, even as he does note at the end of his statement that it is a flawed perspective. Instead of reinforcing misguided or narrow views within the venue of things that can be shared or retweeted instantaneously through the internet, why are we not pointing to years of intellectual history and discussion that prove we should be moving far beyond stereotypes and idealistic assumptions? There are other contemporary examples I can cite as well, but many of them suffer from essentially similar problems. I would simplify them down to three major complaints. One, the Midwest is so many things we can't define it at all. Two, there is a desire to stereotype the Midwest into a neat, idyllic little box. And three, the Midwest isn't generic or simplistic at all. Unfortunately, the poesis who comprise the third complaint are often significantly drowned out by the other two. It seems like much that if the old adage, sex sells, the Midwest may be doomed to serve as a regionally amorphous zone that the rest of the country can use as a generic example of, quote, the good old days. A 2015 CNN piece exploring the Midwest cited historian Andrew Caton noting that very problem. The Midwest, the Midwest, Caton said, has always been a dynamic and diverse place, but that image doesn't fit with what the people want to believe. And by people, Kate means politicians who routinely use the Midwest as a code for a time and place that never actually existed, crime-free and populated with the hardworking people who all look and worship the same. arguing about the Midwest, Caton said, has become arguing about America as a whole. What is actually being missed in this failure to acknowledge a longer intellectual history within the Midwest, and how much should we miss that longer intellectual history? For an example, to look at the origins of some Midwestern literary criticism, book-length studies began to appear in the 1920s that defined Midwestern literature as a cohesive regional literary genre. Two notable examples are Ralph Leslie Rusk's two-volume The Literature of the Middle Western Frontier in 1925, and Dorothy Ann Dondor's The Prairie in the Making of Middle America, Four Centuries of Description in 1926. Rusk's study focused entirely on the frontier period of Midwestern literature and writing. Dondor's study is equally impressive in scope in that she also discusses the region from its origins, but continues the study through to the time of her collection's publication. She observes in the book's foreword that her research will, quote, prove this section has been the subject of numerous and varied interpretations which have reflected all stages of its life, which is something that I think we continually seem to be essentially observing. Dondor also incorporates Carl Van Doren's infamous revolt against the village concept in her discussion, demonstrating the phrase's early accommodation into Midwestern literary study a mere 5 years after Van Doren's 1921 article in The Nation. Of these three early critical references, Van Doren's article has maintained contemporary currency in discussions of the Midwest, while the works by Rusk and Dondor have faded to relative obscurity. And I have a very unscientific way of proving this, as citation tracking in English is terrible. But a quick search of a few recent books on Midwestern literature and references that I pulled, stuff published in the last 5 to 10 years, showed references to Van Doren, but none to Rusk or Dondor. Why are we still deifying Van Doren's revolt as a primary theme in Midwestern literature and culture and not examining it as a comment within a much larger framework? And I'll have to admit that I have fallen into the Van Doren trap as well, but I would like to think I'm in a, you know, reform program. I'm working on it. There's 12 steps. I'll get away with it eventually. So to sort of move beyond and look at some of that broader perspective. Among Midwestern intellectual history, particularly in literature, other names should also be far more common than they are. I'm continually saddened by the lack of awareness of the work of John T. Flanagan. There are few who have ever reached the level of accomplishment of Flanagan in publishing about the Midwest and its literature. In the forthcoming Dictionary of Midwestern Literature, Volume 2, full disclosure, I'm an editorial board member. The bibliography, and I also wrote the bibliography. At the end of the volume lists 11 different articles and publications by Flanagan. And I don't know that that's a definitive list, but it was a readily accessible place for me to sort of track that information. There are actually likely probably a few more. His work categorizing the Midwestern historical novel, farm novel, and protest novel in the early half of the 20th century is still invaluable. I would also note that David D. Anderson, one of the founders of the Society for the Study of Midwestern Literature, appears on that same bibliography with 12 various articles and publications, and again, 12 various articles and publications. And again, that's not a fully comprehensive number. These are just two major names out of a chorus of intellectual voices exploring the Midwest and its literature within the last 100 years. And the work they completed has laid significant groundwork for a substantive discussion of the myths surrounding the Midwest, the problems of definition, the cultural touchstones of the region, and so many other intellectual topics that are still prominent in contemporary debates. My remarks here are limited and mostly non-scientific commentary on the state of popular perceptions of the Midwest, of Midwestern literature and culture. But I do think that there is a considerable need for increased awareness of Midwestern intellectual history. In my embrace of my inner curmudgeon, I do not want to at all send the false impression that I'm against the increased discussion the Midwest is gaining in various contemporary venues, nor against the efforts of great publications like Belt Magazine, in increasing an opportunity for these good debates and discussions. I do, however, feel that in our current media-frenzied, clickbait-oriented world, it is getting far too easy to oversimplify, to reinforce misperceptions about the region, particularly if we fail to take advantage of the groundwork already laid by so many critics and intellectuals on those very same topics. If we're not more precise in our language, if we don't acknowledge the larger context of debates, we're in dangerous territory of keeping ourselves in a perpetual state of regional rediscovery, or continually trying to find ourselves without ever finding understanding.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Our next speaker is Gleaves Whitney, down at the end of the table to my left. Gleaves has been very generous the last few years in terms of organizing this conference and bringing together all these historians and scholars to talk about the Midwest. He has done that in his capacity as director of Grand Valley State University's Hauenstein Center for Presidential Studies. Gleaves, in his spare time, has also authored 14 books, which I won't list here, but he has also put together 300 different programs for the Hauenstein Center and various other institutions. He's taught at University of Michigan, Grand Valley State University, Colorado State, and several other colleges. Whitney is also a senior scholar at the Center for the American Idea in Houston, and he is the first senior fellow at the Russell Kirk Center for Cultural Renewal. His work has appeared in many, many newspapers, magazines, and journals, etc. So, take it away, please.
Thank you, John. Really appreciate that warm introduction. I've got to say, since Annette Kirk is in the room, and we met at the Russell Kirk Center, three years ago, I think that's what really began to launch this project of the Hauenstein Center hosting conferences on the Midwest. I was very excited after meeting John and hearing about these things. I guess we originally met at Jason Duncan's wedding. So we've got a bunch of connections in here. Over
and my wife and I met at Annette's place in La Costa.
There you go. It all happened in the Midwest. And I also just want to say how privileged I feel to be on the same panel with you, John, Sara. Right. Thanks so much for this first-rate work and careers that explore this most interesting topic. I come to the Midwest not as an expert. I'm not from the Midwest originally. I come to the Midwest, to this paper in particular, because I'm from Texas. I'm from Texas originally. And when you grow up in Texas, you have a real keen sense of your state and your region's history. It's so palpable. I mean, you know, field trips to the Alamo, give you, even the kids there, this historic consciousness of something separate and different. And, you know, 10 years as an independent country. And so when I moved to the Midwest to go to graduate school at the University of Michigan, it was my first time in the Midwest, really, and I started wondering about what is the awareness in the Midwest of their own regional history. And I was very disappointed. Ann Arbor, of course, does not even regard itself as Midwest. it regards itself as an aberration in the cornfields. But then when I moved to Lansing and then finally to Grand Rapids, I was disappointed that there wasn't this keen sense of what being a Midwesterner was compared to, say, somebody from Texas. And then the second way that I came to this topic with a sort of more of an amateur interest than a professional scholarly interest was that I had a very practical problem. I'd taken my three boys to Colonial Williamsburg and to the Historic Triangle there. And they were all filled with these ideas of who the founders were. And we get back to Michigan, and it's like, blah. What could be more exciting? We were just in Williamsburg, Washington, D.C., and Yorktown. And so I had to think through and work hard to say, well, you know, boys, there's a connection between what happened at the Historic Triangle and right here in the Midwest. And so this paper that I'm presenting, and it's only a portion of a chapter, goes into some of my rationale for selling the Midwest, actually to my kids. It's where it started. Not that I regard you as children, you're mature, so this is the more mature version of what I told my kids. It's titled, The Hope of the Founders, the Upper Midwest as the Second Promised Land. Well, here at Grand Valley, when I've had the opportunity to teach American history and be Paul Murphy's colleague, and to turn millennials' focus to their home in the Midwest, I find that several points come across as a total surprise to my students. Few are aware, for example, that the greatest Native American civilization north of the Valley of Mexico was centered in the Midwest, or that humankind's first world war was fought in large part to control the resources and the trade of the Midwest, or that the U.S. government waged a 100 years war against the Native Americans that began and ended, at least at the edge, of the Midwest. or that America's founders on the Eastern Seaboard thought that the second promised land, I'm going to repeat that, the second promised land might be realized in the Midwest. The drama of these world historic assertions runs counter to the cliches about the boring Midwest or the vanilla land of America that describes, is encapsulated in this idea of flyover country. Now, peeling back the layers of Midwestern history reveals that it is anything but vanilla. Consider, for example, George Washington. Here's this link, that I was trying to establish with my children. Washington wrote frequently and fervently of the strategic importance of places like the Upper Mississippi Valley, the Great Lakes, and forts like Detroit, which are all through the literature of early America. It is no overstatement to say that Washington, back at Mount Vernon, thought a lot about the future heartland of America. Indeed, after winning independence from Britain, Washington attached world historic significance to these western lands, stretching beyond the Appalachian Mountains north of the Ohio. And in the first place, settling the territory in the Northwest would provide a suitable stage for the unfolding and development of Americans, their civilization. Looking at the Northwest Territory, won from the British, Washington dispatched a 1783 circular to the states in which he wrote, quote, "The citizens of America placed in the most enviable condition as the sole lords and proprietors of a vast tract of continent, comprehending all the various soils and climates of the world and abounding with all the necessaries and conveniences of life, are to be considered as the actors in a most conspicuous theater, which seems to be peculiarly designated by Providence for the display of human greatness and felicity." Close quote. As Washington's words suggest, the new nation was to become more than just another empire. A 1785 letter of his runs thick with biblical allusions about this land that would be called the Midwest, and it anticipates a sonnet by Emma Lazarus that all of you know because it's on the Statue of Liberty. Now listen to Washington's words and see if there's a little plagiarism going on 100 years later from Emma Lazarus. This is Washington, quote, "Let the poor, the needy, and oppressed of the earth, and those who want land, resort to the fertile plains of our western country, the second promised land, and there dwell in peace, fulfilling the first and great commandment." And Washington adds with a dash of humor, "I wish to see the sons and daughters of the world in peace and busily employed, not in war, but in the much more agreeable amusement of fulfilling that first and great commandment, to multiply." So, yes, turns out George Washington had a little bit of a racy sense of humor. That's the closest he ever got to talking about sex in public, folks. He goes on to say, "As an encouragement to which we have opened the fertile plains of the Ohio to the poor, the needy, and the oppressed of the earth, anyone, therefore, who is heavy laden or who wants land to cultivate may repair thither and abound as in the land of promise with milk and honey. The ways are preparing and the roads will be made easy." Is this not out of Isaiah and Matthew and the canon of the Bible that he's quoting here? Clearly to Washington, securing the Northwest was not just another real estate transaction. As his letters throughout the summer of 1785 suggest, opening up our western country to pioneers rose almost to the level of Moses leading the Hebrews to the second land of promise. This audacious vision of this land as an audacious, or as a land of second land of promise, was cultivated not just by Washington, but many of the other founders as well. The Northwest would become their field of dreams, a new republic where pioneers would transform America's wilderness frontier into an empire of liberty. Now, schemes to develop the Northwest were almost as numerous as the founders themselves in dreaming them up. Washington, as you know, had surveyed the West, he had soldiered in the West, and he had this attachment. As an adult, he had these projects where he wanted to connect the Ohio River by means of the Potomac River with a canal and open up this land so that could become the second promised land and you know, establish a national road to the region. And in terms of the impact on the upper Midwest's historic geography, credit must go to several founders in particular. Thomas Jefferson, Alexander Hamilton, and John Adams, for example, all developed ideas for the new republic, including its western lands, that were both overlapping and competing. We see traces of their impact in the West from the 1780s, especially up until the 1830s or so, before Jacksonian democracy starts to overtake their vision. Now, in this paper, I can't go through, the whole chapter goes through Jefferson, Adams, and Hamilton, but in this paper, I only have time, because I know he is a strict text master as a committee chair. This presentation will only focus on Jefferson's ideas that were manifest in the Midwest, partly because it's the most visible. It's for those of you who do not live here, have not spent a lot of time here, I hope this will actually make the intellectual history visible in the landscape. We join intellectual history to historical geography in this presentation to answer the question, how did ideas impact the very American landscape between the founding and the Civil War? And to answer it, focusing on Jefferson, you'll see that we have to develop the idea of an agrarian republic. Now, this would contrast, of course, with Hamilton's commercial republic and Adams's virtuous republic. Now, these are greatly oversimplified terms. They overstate the differences among the three visions, but they also provide useful analytic categories to understand at least a portion of the development of the U.S. after 1780, when these three visions coexisted and would make their mark in the upper Midwest. Now, I realize that by focusing on this, it's a little bit old-fashioned intellectual history. Would be challenged, of course, by Jacksonian Democrats to make these visions somewhat short-lived, and also the crucial question that would be raised by students of Frederick Jackson Turner are overlooked. You know, the Turnerians, neo-Turnerians would argue that the Eurocentric ideals expressed in these Republican institutions were not transplanted whole to the Western frontier, but were grafted onto innovations and adaptations in the West. In this new American environment, old world ideals morphed into something new. You can't just take Jerusalem or Athens or Rome and transplant it to the frontier. It's much more complicated, multi-layered story than that. Would become, through this democratization of, say, the Jeffersonian vision or the Adamsian vision, an Americanized blend. I realize that those are the limits of what I'm about to discuss. Okay, so let's look at the Jeffersonian landscape. Jefferson's contributions to shaping the Northwest are significant. Recall that this territory right here, along with Ohio and Indiana and Illinois, they're actually the Northwest part of Virginia in 1783 and 1784. When the Virginia Session turned the land over to Congress, Jefferson had a stake in the how the region would be disposed. The Sage of Monticello exercised two kinds of leadership when it came to forming the future Midwest. One was the intellectual leadership he provided through a voluminous body of writing that articulated what a homegrown republic, an American republic, should look like. At the center of Jefferson's political philosophy, which was influenced both by Lockean liberal and classical Republican traditions, I know that's a controversial statement, but I'm sticking with it. It's both traditions, and Jefferson's was an ideal of an agrarian or pastoral republic. Republics in the ancient world often faltered over the lack of available land for the expanding population of yeoman farmers, but with abundant new lands and a rational land policy, the American republic had a chance to succeed where earlier republics had failed. He's thinking most of all of Rome. The American West was meant to attract independent, enlightened farmers who were not enthralled to the big banks and the money men back east. The states were to be the primary instruments of Republican principle. Thus, the national government would be strictly contained within its constitutional limits, and the resulting federal budget was to be small. So compelling was this vision that generations of Jeffersonian Arcadians would advance this ideal, arguably, most famously, with the passage of the Homestead Act of 1862, but also up through the presidency of Grover Cleveland at the end of the 19th century, and I would even argue up through the presidency of Calvin Coolidge in the 1920s. This Jeffersonian ideal remained alive. If you go to Homestead National Monument in Nebraska, you'll see a map that shows the progress of the Homestead Act. We always think of it as a 19th century thing. It goes well into the 1920s and even in the 1930s, for example, in shaping the Northwest. The other kind of leadership that Jefferson provided was, of course, political. Recall that he served as a delegate to the Confederation Congress when it was debating what to do with the Northwest. In this role, he cultivated proteges in Congress, like James Monroe. He inspired the Virginia secession that we just spoke of, and he wrote most of the Ordinance of 1784, which argued for an enlightened land policy for pioneers who would settle the newly opened territory and eventually organize states. This law and the debates surrounding it would deeply inform the Land Ordinance of 1785 and, of course, the famous Northwest Ordinance of 1787, parts of which have been lifted through every succeeding constitution that Michigan has composed. And you can see the Northwest Ordinance's Article 3 on education, which I might get around to quoting in a few minutes, lifted and put in verbatim to our current Michigan Constitution, which was composed in the early 1960s. The Jeffersonians contributed to the historical geography of the Upper Midwest by leaving four distinct marks on the landscape. First is the rectangular grid survey by which the land was measured and sold to Eastern investors and hardscrabble settlers. The first time I flew with my family over the Midwest, and I pointed out the window and said, "That's Thomas Jefferson." You were actually looking at Jefferson's idea when you looked down at that landscape with its neat squares. The land was measured and sold to Eastern investors, hardscrabble settlers. The township and range surveying comes straight out of the instructions from the Land Ordinance of 1785 and gives the region its long straight roads, this checkerboard or quilt, and the rectangles of various dimensions give us, I think, a landscape which is relatively unusual in the world. Jefferson's seemingly infinite township and range lines cut indiscriminately. I want you to note this point. For being a man of nature and of sensitive to natural history, it's curious that Jefferson's grid survey cuts indiscriminately across watersheds, hilltops, lakeshores, wetlands, irrespective of topography. His vision represented the triumph of enlightenment utility over romantic nature. The rectangular grid stipulated by the Land Ordinance of 1785 certainly contrasts with the British colonial British meets and bounds system that you find on the East Coast, and it compares more subtly with the colonial Spanish laws of the Indies on the West Coast. I went back and I read those Spanish laws. Even the Spanish are more sensitive. They want settlements to be in a grid, but they have to be rightly proportioned with a river. There has to be a Native American settlement nearby. It has to be 13, 14 miles from the seacoast. This is why Los Angeles is not a beach town. You know, the downtown, the old part of Los Angeles is 12, 13, 14 miles inland so that it cannot be raided by marauding pirates, that kind of thing. So Jefferson is oblivious to history and to nature. It is truly a pure crystalline form of the Enlightenment, which is an intellectual problem in itself that I think would bear tackling. Joe Hogan, that might be an interesting dissertation for you someday. I also want to say something about, we often overlook the people, the men mostly, and their families who went with them, who surveyed this great tract of township and range. They are the unsung heroes of the Midwest. We hardly mention them at all. And yet think, I mean, I don't know about you, but if you try to just walk across a stretch of Michigan, if you tried that with the marshland and then the river and then thick, dense forest, it is hard work. These people were truly heroic, and we don't say enough about it. Lansing, Michigan, for a time, had a wonderful museum, a National Museum of Surveying, And I was sorry to see that it closed a few years and was absorbed by another museum. I think we ought to bring back the National Museum of Surveying, these heroes, truly. Now the rectangular grid, as I said, reflected utility as well as reason. Jefferson, a man of the Enlightenment, argued for the Cartesian grid, and I use that word deliberately, a Cartesian grid, very separated from the material, to keep order in lands that would be rapidly settled and invested in. With the grid, every sale could be identified by its township number, range number, section, subsection, and lot. Folks, if any of you bought land in rural Michigan or elsewhere in the Midwest, that system is still in use today for the land transaction. This whole concept was borrowed, Jefferson borrows it from the military engineers that he knew. Men like the first geographer of the United States, Thomas Hutchins, who in turn had borrowed it, this grid from Roman and Crusader military colonies. Actually, go back and look at the maps of the Crusades. Crusades have a bad name, we're not supposed to talk about it. But in terms of an idea of organizing space, intellectual history on historic geography here, what we're doing, those towns that were established, the new towns established in the Holy Land, 700 years earlier, were on the exact same kind of grid that Hutchins would pick up and then talk to Jefferson about. A second distinctive mark of the Jeffersonian landscape was mile after mile of isolated farmsteads built by these yeoman farmers with the aid of neighbors. This is the reason Midwestern hinterland so little resembles the European hinterland. You know, in feudal Europe, many peasants traced their settlements to medieval times when they lived in village workshops outside the castle walls. And the reason for compact villages for the lower orders so that they could be more easily controlled by the landed gentry and the knights and corralled into a confined space if they got too uppity. Now, Jefferson found these crowded European settlements not only unhealthy, but also undignified for a free people. In theory, Americans were not to be the vassals of anyone, certainly not the money men and the bankers. He did not want to see crowded towns and cities mar either the American character or the American landscape. But this is why I forgive Jefferson a little bit for this unsympathetic grid to the natural topography or to history. There is a motivation behind it that I think needs to be fleshed out. We can't do that in this paper, but in the US, as you know, each farmhouse was to be the castle of its own lot of land and set a little back from the nearby baseline or meridian road. Each American citizen would be a feudal lord, as it were. Now, a third feature of the Jeffersonian landscape was the iconic one-room schoolhouse either located in or supported by Erie Township Section 16. So, for example, up near where Annette Kirk lives in Mecosta County, there is literally a Section 16 that is school section with a lake in it, and it is called School Section Lake. See how imaginative we Midwesterners are. But this Section 16 is an amazing legacy of the American experiment. The provision of the land ordinance in 1785 provided a focus for the yeoman households scattered throughout the township. These schoolhouses were meant to be the backbone of a powerful Republican institution, a network of schools that instilled economic independence, political community, and some sense of Republican civic duty and leadership. Like the Land Ordinance of 1785, the Northwest Ordinance of 1787 made public education a cultural centerpiece. And I promised you I'd read something out of Section 3, Article 3 of the Northwest Ordinance, which, as I say, is in many of the constitutions of this part of the United States. Quote, religion, morality, and knowledge being necessary to good government and the happiness of mankind, schools and the means of education shall forever be encouraged. Now, this remarkable provision anticipated not only the spectacular growth of publicly supported schools throughout the United States, but also later a number of distinguished land grant universities. The ordinances promoted at once a liberal and a practical education. Speaking of the American farmer, Jefferson was proud that, quote, ours are the only farmers that can read Homer, close quote. When he wrote, if a nation expects to be ignorant and free, and in a state of civilization, it expects what never was and never will be. Close quote. And a little poetry there for you. The sage of Monticello famously argued, "I know of no safe depository of the ultimate powers of the society, but the people themselves. And if we think them not enlightened enough to exercise their control with a wholesome discretion, the remedy is not to take it from them, but to inform their discretion by education." Close quotation. Boy, I'd love to insert that in current political debates. A fourth and final Jeffersonian feature on our upper Midwestern landscapes has to do with architecture. Because of Jefferson's own classical education, he approached the Northwest with an ancient ideal in view, an Arcadia, that of an agrarian or pastoral republic. Pastoral societies had long been at the root of Western civilization, among the ancient Hebrews, the Greeks, and the Romans all. An ideal that Jefferson hoped to continue in some form in the new American Republic, in this novus ordo seclorum, this new order of the ages that was to be the American experiment. His hope was that the American frontier would live up to its Arcadian potential by being transformed into a republican society of freedom-loving farmers. For that reason, the architect of Monticello was an advocate of Greek Revival and Roman Republican architecture to give the young nation a visual vocabulary, a yeoman virtue grafted onto ordered freedom. To sum up, because the ordinances reflect Jefferson's debt to John Locke and the Enlightenment, the Jeffersonian vision is optimistic. It's bullish on human nature. It believes in the efficacy of education in the pursuit of happiness. Yes, that nexus, education in the pursuit of happiness, is combines then his work in the 1780s with his important work in Philadelphia in 1776. He believed in the possibilities of educating citizens for independence and in the development of an empire of liberty. Democracy and relative equality of holdings would foster the growth of a large middling class of farmers as opposed to the corrupt money men in their corrupt cities, especially back east. Freedom and individualism would cultivate a yeoman class of homesteaders who could not be herded into unhealthy, crowded settlements where they'd be easy to control. The heart of the Jeffersonian's agrarian republic was to be found in the vast spaces settled by what we heard earlier this morning, the common man, each a new world lord of his 640 acres. Thank you.
Gleaves, we have more than 20 minutes for questions here, and I'd kind of like to start us off with Gleaves' concluding comment there, which connects what Gleaves said to Andrew Seal. And I'm going to ask both Gleaves and Andrew to comment on this connection I'm going to draw and tell me if you think it's correct. But what Gleaves is talking about, I guess, is the earliest form of Midwestern intellectual history in the sense that these were the first people to kind of comment on the region and have a vision for how the region should be organized and how it should be run. You know, when Washington and the others are describing what he sees as the future of the region, I mean, that's the first serious commentary about it. But you end with Jefferson and you talk about the Homestead Act and land open for the common man and public schooling for the common man, and then you have this wonderful phrase about yeoman Midwestern farmers reading Homer. This sort of a vision of this anti-medieval vision for the Midwest. This is going to be a different order, as you say, for the ages, a place where each of these individuals has a certain sort of small R republican dignity. Anyway, that sounds to me like Merle Curdy. That sounds like Merle Curdy growing up in Papillion, Nebraska, and developing these early notions of the Midwestern common man. Is this a kind of connection we can make? I'll open it up to Gleaves and Andrew to take that on.
Well, all I will say about Merle Curdy is that one of my advisors at Michigan was David Hollinger, and in a, Andrew, you'll enjoy this, in a office hour, he sort of closed his door a little bit, and he said, "I shouldn't admit this, but I like Merle Curdy way too much." But I think it was precisely because of this very interesting layering. Andrew, you know so much more about this, and I defer to you, but it is interesting that actually Merle Curdy's half-life is quite long in our discussions of him, and maybe precisely it's because of this genius of combining, you know, the common man with this idea of an informed republic.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. You know, but I think that also he, Paul wrote a really great essay on the growth of American thought. You talked about how a number of people have been kind of like, yeah, it's a little boring. It's just kind of a conglomeration of a lot of these. I think it has more of an argument than some of these critics, kind of Lynn or people like that. But you know, I think that the issue of the informed citizen is absolutely central. And I think that it does go right back to the Jeffersonian ideal that is represented in the 1785, 1787 ordinances. And I think that it's interesting, some of this early history, because you have some extremely federalist ideas as well. The settlement at Marietta is, you know, a much more business venture. And so there are multiple threads running through there, but still, Nessa Cutler and the other people who were organizing this original settlement in the Northwest Territory maintained that perspective of the importance of public education and of universal, or what they would have thought of at the time as universal education.
I like that comment about Marietta, because that of course elides into the Hamiltonian Republic.
Right,
and,
yeah.
You know, Chicago becomes the greatest, you know, illustration of what the Hamiltonian Republic will look like here in the Midwest.
Let's open it up for early comments.
Paul, I had a question for Ray Boomhower about John Barlow Martin, just as politics. And as a New Dealer, it's kind of interesting contrast with the Jeffersonian tradition. But I'm interested in his experience in the 1960s, and I was intrigued that you said he worked for these for the Democratic presidential nominees from states and through McGovern, and that he was also close with Schlesinger, and I presume kind of maybe in line with that Bible center kind of Cold War liberal thing. So how did you feel moving from 68 through 72? Was he just a sort of dutiful party man, or is it his own politics?
He's an old-fashioned FDR liberal, I would term him. He felt kind of out of place by 1972, and the young McGovern staffers really didn't know what to do with him. And he felt kind of out of it. It was a little disconcerting for him to work in the same office as the speechwriter for McGovern as Arthur Schlesinger's son, Peter. That was kind of odd. And I mentioned that his son said his idea of hell was academic life, but he did have something of an academic life. He worked for about a decade at Northwestern in the Middle School of Journalism, and felt himself a little out of touch with the young students of the time in the 70s, the era of Watergate, where every budding reporter wanted to be an investigative journalist like Woodward and Bernstein. And he was an old-fashioned, stupid white man when it came to writing. Put yourself in the background. These other young writers wanted to put themselves in the foreground. So he was out of step with them. Also was appalled at their lack of writing ability, which I think is a common thing even today.
I share that.
Just follow up, Ray, one thing that struck me is you used the phrase, these mood of the Midwest articles, which you can just see them transpiring. You know, the editor in New York of Time Magazine calling out to Indiana or whatever. Martin, go out and get us a article about what they're saying and
what's going on in the Midwest these days.
But that whole process, to me, sort of makes the point about how the Midwest is. I mean, they're treating Martin as sort of a foreign correspondent. It's like they're talking to somebody, their man in Paris.
Right.
Just some news of what's going on in France. But that whole mentality sort of makes the point about regionalism or how the Midwest is seen as a different place.
I think a lot of these New York editors were transplanted Midwesterners themselves. And so they had the connections back there and wanted to know what was going on back to where they had come from. Mark was someone who decided, made a conscious decision to stay in the Midwest. And he had opportunities throughout his career to go to the East Coast, to join the staffs of these magazines, become an editor himself. And he always refused that and felt comfortable here in the Midwest as a Midwest.
Other questions?
Well, this has nothing to do with anything, but was he a lifelong smoker?
He was.
Did you pick that up from the throat cancer?
Schlesinger, in his book of letters that I have in my office, bemoans all the people he had known throughout his life who he lost to the evil of smoking. John Barlow was one of them. He tried to kick the habit at one time, but his mood became so foul that even his psychiatrist urged him to go back to smoking. Difficult to deal with without.
Are there regions within regions in the Midwest? For instance, when I think of the Midwest, I really don't think of South Dakota and way out that far. Where does it end? and where does it begin? And you know, I have people that feel differently about different things.
Well, I was just going to say that one of the things I encounter teaching in the South, as much as we think of a monolithic South, there is no monolithic South. So I think the Midwest falls in the same boat that way, where, you know, and people in Alabama feel like they, a lot of times, they have nothing in common with North Carolinians, and yet that's all the South, at least if you're going with certain geography. So I think the idea of regions within regions is definitely right. We have some geographical boundary that sets out at least the larger scope of region, but there's definitely sub-regions.
Absolutely, I completely agree. We should talk to Ray about this. I've got an idea for a book about the Midwest's sub-regions that maybe your press would be interested in. But if you broke it down, you could do a chapter on the Upper Peninsula. You could do a chapter on the Driftless area of Wisconsin. You could, you know, figure out this cutoff line in Missouri where Missouri becomes Southern.
Well, the exclusive sort of Rust Belt section a little bit with the more industrial side of the Midwest as opposed to the more agrarian side.
Right, Indiana becomes Southern.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
Ohio.
South of I-70.
Ohio is the same issue. Yeah. You get to a certain point in Ohio, and it's completely different culture.
Well, Cairo, Illinois feels like the South to me.
Yeah. One last comment, and then we'll have this gentleman talk. But we had a conference at the Center for Western Studies about a year ago where we took up this question about, this is exactly a Ned's question, where does it end? And we have a book coming out in about a year, the title of which is, Where Does the Midwest End and the Great Plains Begin? Essays on the Interior Borderlands. Because there is this, and I have a very specific idea of where it ends. If you have driven on I-90 west, you get past Mitchell, South Dakota, home of the Corn Palace. Somewhere west of Mitchell, before you get to the Missouri River, things start to look a lot more western. It gets more arid, there's less rain, there's more cowboy hats, there's more Indian reservations, there's more topography, and pretty soon you're in the Badlands, and you know, you're definitely in something different from the Midwest. So we have 20 different people writing essays on where does it end and where does it begin. So just hold on, it'll be coming soon. Yes, this man.
The New York Times, just when I was looking at what the attitudes in the Midwest were, used to go to Paris to New Jersey.
One of my favorite Ford Maddox Ford things is that basically defines the Midwest as everything west of Altoona. I mean, he just lumped everything into that.
I wanted to ride on John's statement and say, people in Missouri, I guess I represent Missouri, I can't believe I'm saying that, because I'm not a Missourian, would say there's no part of Missouri that's the South. The part you're referring to is the Ozarks, which straddles the South, which is not really Southern. The question is, what part of Arkansas is South, and what part is Ozarks? Different question.
Yeah. No, I think.
But you can read my chapter in his book. I discuss that.
Gleaves and I were we were talking about this a year ago. This came up because we started this project, that's now a book, on where does the Midwest end and the Plains begin. And Gleaves and I started to talk about a book about what's the dividing line between South and Midwest? Mm-hmm. And that's where you're going to get into this question of Missouri, which would be, you know, Exhibit A in this debate.
Yes.
But also Cairo.
It's very similar Southern, very similar Midwestern, but Ozarkans have their own culture or cultures.
There was a good essay about 2 months ago, and this was prompted by the presidential campaign, where someone was talking about the Indiana primary, and I forget who it was who wrote it, but they put out a 2,000-word essay saying, remember, that Indiana is the most southern Midwestern state, and the person went through the migration patterns about who migrated up into Indiana and how it was fairly heavily southern dominated for many years, and you know, still has that influence. Whereas a place like Wisconsin has a lot of Yankees, mm-hmm. it has a lot of migrants, Germans, immigrants, people like that, and has a huge foreign-born population at the end of the 19th century, whereas Indiana is much less so. So again, this speaks to this whole point about interior regions in the Midwest.
And how much contemporary migration is changing regions too. I think, you know, the huge Arab American population in Michigan, I mean, now has made Michigan, I mean, there's historically, you know, you've got all of these great sort of ethnic groups that have, you know, populated the region, but even now all of a sudden it's different. It's a very different regional dynamic in many places, which I think is interesting to think about that a lot.
If I could just add, there is a wonderful book out by one of our keynoters from last year's conference, Colin Woodard, came up with American Nations. And if you look just at the upper Midwest, mm-hmm. He calls that Yankeedom. I mean, it's this swath of counties that he analyzed from New England through New York, Western New York, then of course the Erie Canal makes it possible for New Yorkers to come over. But this Yankeedom is really an interesting and intriguing concept for the interior regions within the Midwest. John, you probably thought about it over, I noticed you and Colin our Facebook buddies, maybe you've thought about how coherent that thesis is and what are some of the questions that we're hearing.
Right. And connected to that, the question is, you said Western New York, and where is the eastern boundary of the Midwest? Because I had to drive from Albany, New York, which is very much an eastern city, to Iowa, back and forth twice a year for years on graduate school. And now again, and I really didn't know Western New York much. I grew up in Albany, East, this part of the state, but somewhere like west of Syracuse, you know, like Batavia, like John just said, this area west of Mitchell before the Missouri River, and a little town called Batavia, you know, be really flatter and small towns, and I would think, am I the Midwest? Does the Midwest start here? Maybe, and then I forget about Philadelphia and Rochester and Buffalo, and then in Ohio, west of Cleveland, the bunch of the trees. And I would think, this is the Midwest now. That eastern beginning I've always been intrigued with. You know, right. The Ohio state line, I mean, it's...
And of course that cutover region of western New York, that is what produced a lot of the people that came in and adopted these Midwestern groups. Michael,
I think Turner sees Pittsburgh as the beginning of the Midwest. And he has some visions of, you know, Braddock and so forth. And so you could argue that it's my wife was from Delaware, felt she was in the Midwest. She was in that part of Pennsylvania. But I do have a quick question for Sara. Did D.L. Parrington fit into this? And
probably.
Yeah, because he strikes me as so important. You know,
yeah.
His stuff. He's from Kansas, I think.
And, yeah, I have to say, if I had a little more time,
yeah.
I'd probably be a little bit deeper substance in my screed. But I think definitely.
Because I really like what you're doing, and I thought of Constance Rourke, but I think she's an Easterner. But
yeah.
She does talk about the interior, and you know. So.
Yeah, I mean, a lot some of this is, you know, my comments today were particularly marketed at, you know, what I've been seeing shared on Facebook. but that's also becoming the new medium,
yeah.
though, for people. I mean, you know, it's part of why politically people are becoming so much more insular in their thinking in a lot of ways, because they're able to share all these things that are a lot of times completely erroneous, which is a whole other story of mine. But this idea that we can circulate this stuff and make it as if it's a unanimous,
yeah.
you know, oh, everybody should read this, everybody should agree with this, and I do think that's affecting Midwest, the definition of Midwest. It ties into the question of the plenary about what are contemporary communications doing to sort of our definition. And one of my fears is that it's playing into the stereotypes very much so.
Just to follow up on something Sara said in her talk, she talked a little bit about how we've lost or forgotten all these second-tier writers. I mean, we remember Hemingway is from Chicago, and Fitzgerald's from St. Paul, et cetera, but after two or three, we lose all these other writers who, in their day, were very prominent and important. And I don't think Tricia Oman is here, but
she's
we...
She's in another section at the same time, yeah.
Well, we are engaged in this book project, which is going to result in a book called The Midwestern Moment, Early 20th Century Midwestern Regions. Yeah, it's up to three volumes.
Yeah.
But the point of it is to try and reconnect with those second-tier writers who no one remembers and kind of give them a voice and, you know, bring them up in the archives and give them some life because no one knows. Like August Derleth, for example, which you brought up, the Wisconsin writer, regionalist, lived in Wisconsin his entire life, wrote an amazing number of books.
A lot of literary history, too.
Yeah.
There are historical novels, too, about the history of Wisconsin. I mean, it's one of the greatest ways, I think, for a lot of people to even access some of that history if they don't want to actually pull out the history book. I mean,
But this kind of recovery effort, I think, is one of our primary goals as part of this whole Midwestern Studies movement. And
yeah, I was going to follow up on that a bit and ask Sara, how do you think some of the challenges of your work compared to the challenges of people who study middle brow literature, where they're also trying to recover, you know, some of these second tier writers that are always being forgotten, right, and being rediscovered, and how there's this sort of recursive process of feeling like we've never really gotten them to a point where there's a sort of permanence.
Well, there was a quote I was almost going to put in, and I can't remember now if it's John Updike exactly or who, but it was a writer like that who, one of my favorite Midwestern writers is Dawn Powell.
Right.
And he said 20 years ago, she may just be doomed to a perpetual state of revival, and if you look at any of the public, it's sort of almost,
Now she's in the Library of America.
Well, she is, but at the same time, she's in the Library of America and still having Dawn Powell. I mean, so she's got a place, and Tim Page's work has been fantastic, and it's much easier to go to a bookstore now and find her on the shelf. But I still, you know, a lot of times when I talk to people, it's a lot of these lesser-known Midwestern writers tend to be sort of almost insider people. Like, you meet people who know them, and you're like, oh, wow, you know them, you know, and you can have this whole sort of insider dialogue. A lot of it is changing, you know, some of what we lament in terms of the Midwest, in terms of... nobody seeing that distinctiveness is changing some of that expectation that it is not distinctive to begin with. And I think that's a slow process, and I don't know how you fix that. And I think it's the same similar sort of thing that goes in with that middle ground literature. How do you change this idea of a literature as elite and not sort of recognize some of these writers that may not have achieved, you know, sort of Nobel Prize status? And a lot of that's changing sort of, I think, our approach toward intellectualism in general and stuff too. And then being more open to acknowledgement of that, because I mean, as much as I see sort of, I'm happy at some of the evolution I see among academics, there are still conferences I go to that I end up in conversations with people where I'm like, oh God, this is like the nightmare scenario from you know, like an academic hell where you're having this stuffy conversation where, you know, and the person sort of got like, so what do you do? And as long as you're still having some of those moments, you're still gonna have that battle. It's also why I'm interested to hear about the Midwestern Studies plenary at the lunch after lunch, because I do sort of wonder if we had greater recognition, at least for this Midwestern component, if we had greater recognition of Midwestern Studies as a area of study, which we don't have, as far as I'm aware, really any hugely public acknowledgement that it is. I mean, we all walk around going, yeah, it is. But it's, the comment I made at the very before the panel even started is there are no jobs ever advertised for a specialist in Midwestern literature, like no jobs. I've seen Appalachian literature, I've seen Southwestern literature, I've seen Western literature. There's never been a school on the planet that said, you know, and I'm not even saying it's a full-on specialization, but even as a sub-specialization, that said, you know, we want an Americanist who knows, you know, Midwestern writers. never, in the 8 or 9 years I've been looking at the market, it's never happened. And I don't know anybody who has that job. So, you know, as long as we're not recognizing it even as sort of an area of study, I kind of wonder how much we're going to take some of it seriously or look at the
don't forget the fact writers, too.
Just to bring this full circle, the reason a lot of these people have fallen into second-tier status or just been forgotten entirely is a function of the implosion of Midwestern studies, because there aren't scholars out there doing this kind of work.
And people who don't know, I mean, like my dissertation director, I mean, and bless him, he let me roll with it, but when I even pitched that I wanted to, I initially started with August Ehrlich, because that's what I did my master's thesis on. I said, well, I want to keep working on like August Ehrlich and people like him, and they were like, you will never get a job unless you attach it to some big names. And I mean, so as long as we're, and it's true, but it, at the same time, as long as we have that mentality, as long as somebody's not saying, no, write that best Streeter Aldrich dissertation, you know, like roll with it, you know, run with it, see what it, because you're going to have search committees who aren't going to hire those people.
So my question is actually a follow-up to that kind of. I was curious about the second title that you came up with in the intern kids these days. This is still your grandfather's literary Midwest, was that it?
Yeah, something
so like I'm wondering if built into that is not only a lament of sort of the blind spot of scholarship and criticism, but also of if you see a frozenness in the canon, if there's also a lament of like today's Midwest, like today's Midwest literary generation, if you see them failing to read that canon and carry it forward or participate in that tradition.
And people who are working on the Midwest, and especially in sort of surveying what's been happening, particularly at the study, Society for the Study of Midwestern Literature conferences, I mean, we're shipping up the can all the time. We're bringing in unknown voices. I mean, you're still gonna see a slate of Willa Cather papers, you're still gonna see a slate of Fitzgerald, and I wouldn't knock them off. I mean, Cather's fantastic, Fitzgerald's fantastic. It's not at all about excluding those. But there's some fantastic things being done. The problem is that you know most of that's going to happen when you know the crowd. You get outside that circle, and that discussion all of a sudden falls away very quickly. Mm-hmm. And that's what I find problematic. And I also find it a little problematic because I think you know, people aren't picking up. Well, I mean, to mention Krishna Mahan again and Hastings College Press, which she started. Mainly as a student project press at her college to teach students about publishing, but it focuses particularly on, in a lot of ways, law student texts. And that's also part of our problem is if you can't buy these books, if you can't find these books on shelves, how are you going to read them? You know, I mean, a lot of this stuff even is pretty accessible. If, you know, going to the King Books and looking on the used bookshelves, I can find a whole bunch of writers I like. But that's not, you know, people are going to have to find, if you can find good used bookstores, it's difficult these days. So it's getting harder and harder in some cases to access these texts.
So if we can't even access the texts, are you worried that then the canon is static, that it's sort of stuck in this time and people can't read it, so how can they participate in that tradition and bring it into the
public? Yeah, very much so. Or how can they even have the discussions? I mean, my work on John Herman is a little bit of a, you know, yay, let's go for the underdog, because I mean, he's somebody who's completely fallen by the wayside. And I don't know that he was ever a great writer, but part of my lament when I talk about him is how can we even discuss whether he was a great writer, because you can't find any of his stuff. And we can't even talk about why he was a crummy writer, because he doesn't get his stuff. So,
I have a procedural question. Do I have to ask each authors for a copy of the papers? Is there some way that I can get the papers for the entire conference?
I'm guessing they would share, but it's also being recorded, the session, if you want to hear it again. It'll be on YouTube soon. But
right. The Hauenstein Center posts every one of these. It'll be up in about 3-4 days. So you can look at it to your heart's content there.
Any other questions? All right. Oh, well, you want to follow up? Yeah. Annette's got the last question.
Yeah, I don't know if this is relevant or not, but as I'm thinking about this and all the emphasis on the academic, and this is an academic conference in this setting, of course, and I suppose that's how things are determined, who can write and the level of the writing. But there is also independent writers out there. And one of the things that the little local libraries in Michigan has done, and ours is very good at this, in our little village, you know, our library, is feature people who have written, credible writers, the Dempsey brothers, Ink Trails, Part 1, Part 2. Now, they do have Hemingway in there, but they have all kinds of other people in there that I never heard of. And they don't have a political agenda, and so there's a lot of women, and they're not in there because they're feminists or suffragettes or something like that. They've done incredible things in their villages and their towns. And so I think that I wonder sometimes, these conferences are so academic, because it's depending on jobs and everything, that's why they get boring. And that therefore they should bring in some other people who are public writers.
Well, I admit, I'm not an academic.
Oh.
I'll put in a good word for if you're looking for books of that sort, look to the Midwestern presses of the historical side,
right.
Like Wisconsin,
yeah.
Minnesota,
yeah.
Indiana Historical Society Press.
Mm-hmm.
We're putting out books on the Midwest all the time. Then, or not.
Yeah.
Quite scholarly, you're trying to reach a broader popular
and
audience.
Right.
A lot of actually academic presses are pushing
yes.
more for non-scholarly,
yeah.
You know, where it's not dry material.
Right. And they don't have to be non-scholarly necessarily, but they can be really interesting. They're not just speaking to other scholars.
They can have a scholarly apparatus, as my Martin book does.
Right.
You know,
exactly.
I have a master's degree, but they're trying to reach a
mm-hmm.
popular audience.
Great.
Thanks, everybody. Great session.